Hello YouTube. We have something a little bit different for you today. I'm here with Stephen Woodford of Rationality Rules and Cole Nasrella. And you know, we're going to be just having a chat about moral realism, possibly egoism. As I'm saying this, I realize we haven't actually specified exactly what we're going to have a chat about, so can't put that in the introduction. So one of the reasons why we're doing this is, you know, I think we kind of got chatting a bit because me and Cole did this video on Sam Harris, and then a bit later you did a video on Sam Harris, and we got in contact as a result of us both kind of doing this, covering this topic at around the same time. One of the things that I think has become clear through chatting to you at other times is that the kind of concerns that motivate people when they talk about ethics and, you know, meta-ethics, questions about morality, I guess outside of academic philosophy, are sometimes at something of a tangent to what academic philosophers are concerned with. And so it seemed like it might be fruitful to, I guess, just discuss these different approaches. Well, that's pretty much it. That's the introduction. So,
yeah, that's good.
Anybody want to add anything?
Awesome introduction as always. I've got the hello YouTube, the classic Kane. Hopefully what I can bring to the conversation here, because you two are both in the field. You know, you're a professor. You're finishing your PhD, if I'm not mistaken, Kane. Mm-hmm. I can come at it from a layman's perspective, someone that's learned philosophy and moral philosophy just through my own sources and links, and talking to people, like just going out and talking to various people from all sorts of different fields that are not in academia. And as you said, there's almost like a failure of communication with keywords, and I'm guilty for it as well. I've realized from talking to you both that I'm using words in different ways. And so it would explain why there's this frustration and this disconnect. So hopefully what we can do today is bridge that and then maybe ask the more interesting question of why that's happening. Because it certainly does seem to be the case with, you know, terms like moral realism and what it means to be objective and whatnot. So yeah, I'm excited for this. So thanks for your time and thanks for having me on.
Right.
Thanks for reaching out to me in the first place.
Something I've experienced, I'm wondering if you two have as well, is with Hume's guillotine, there seems to be a guillotine of itself going on where either people just get it or they don't. And it's like, there's no middle ground. They really do just get it. And like, that's why you see the same kind of criticisms coming out. Alex O'Connor has done a similar criticism to Harris. So has Sean Carroll. And while mine's different and yours is different, it's fundamentally the same thing. Whereas the people that don't understand it seem to royally not understand it, if that makes sense. I don't know if that's been your experience from seeing it, but you see, that's been mine at least.
Kane, do you want to take that first?
Yeah, well, I guess I
have a tangent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A rant that I can go on about it. So this is, we discussed talking about the difference between subjective and objective at the beginning of this video. And this is part of the reason I think doing that is so important, because when you have the is-ought gap, you make this jump that a lot of people, based on their assumptions about what is objective and what is subjective, they don't see it as a jump, right? So in that example I gave that you used and Kane is familiar with, it's dangerous to ride motorcycles, implicit premise, you shouldn't do dangerous things, or not. We can take that out for the sake. Therefore, you should not ride motorcycles, right? If people will understand that the danger is potentially objective, right? But if they're moral realists, most likely they think that ought premise is also objective. And they're not going to see that introduction of a non-factual claim coming into the argument all of a sudden. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think this is actually the first really key word to get defined, because I totally get what you're saying, but I wouldn't have a long time ago. And the reason for that is, if you take the word objective and how it's used in science, you know, it refers to factual things about the world in a factual state, a descriptive state, purely descriptive rather than prescriptive. And then subjective gets used in colloquial terms to mean that it's not objective. It's something to do with personal. But that's not what moral philosophers are meaning when they use these words. And I think that seems to be where, they're not using the precise same definitions from what I can tell. And that is a major confusion, because then you get Sam Harris and people like that saying, no, this is an objective fact that relates to the world. It's not my opinion that this will hurt you. It will hurt you. You can see that's where a lot of the confusion just breaks down to objective and what is objective. So that might be a good place to unpack.
Ken, does that make sense to you?
Well, I think that I think most moral philosophers would accept that if you have something like, if you put your hand on a hot stove, it will hurt you, that's an objective fact. Because, you know, we can specify the state of the stove and the way in which it interacts with the hand, and then the experiences that will be produced from that. I mean, these are all, that will either happen or it won't, right? And it doesn't really depend on what anybody thinks about it. So I think in that sense, the term objective seems to me to be being used in the same way.
Fair enough. I can pass that out a little bit, right? So go on.
No, just to finish the point, I think the key thing is that what a lot of people who are taking that kind of Harris line want to say is, well, when you say, if you put your hand on the hot stove, it will hurt you, right? And assuming that you don't want to get hurt, right? That's basically all you really need in order to make moral claims, right? Like, that's all moral claims need to consist in. And so then you get seemingly objective moral facts, because there are facts about what people desire and there are facts about how best to realize those desires. So there you go. Whereas in moral philosophy, at least meta-ethics, that's not really how the terminology is being used. I don't know if it's a disagreement about objective as much as it's more just a different use of that term, moral. But maybe that.
I see what you mean. Maybe because you could say objective in the sense of just like it's describing a fact, or you could say objective is in the context of like a hypothetical imperative. If you want X, you ought to do Y, or Y is conducive to X. You can speak in that in objective terms. But that's not describing a fact or a descriptive state purely. It's also a prescriptive. You could have that as an objective prescriptive statement based or predicated on that hypothetical imperative, if that makes sense to you both at all.
I don't want to move too far away from what I think is like the most important thing about what you initially said and about that distinction. And I think this is where Kane and I are blind and why you are so helpful to us. And I think Kane missed it. I don't think colloquially we use objective and subjective incorrectly, not particularly. The fact that I think iced tea is too sweet is subjective. That's effectively what that is. But what philosophers of all sorts are going to describe the feature of being objective as is being mind independent. So when we have a premise like, if you put your hand on a hot stove, you will get burned. People ought not do things that burn them, right? Something like that. You can't get to that subjective ought with no minds. There's no fact in the world independent of human beings. There's no objective fact in the world that people ought not do things that hurt them or ought not burn themselves. We can imagine circumstances where maybe people ought to burn themselves. I'm thinking of that religious fellow who lit himself on fire. Somewhere in Asia, right? Clearly, based on his values and his desires and his outcome, he thought he should burn himself, right? And he did. So there's no mind independent objective fact in the world that's going to have that prescriptive value. And that's where we get into trouble. Nobody's doubting that if you don't want to get burned, then you shouldn't put your hand on a hot stove. People are doubting that there is a mind independent fact floating around in the world that says, don't burn, don't hurt, don't stab or steal or lie or any of these other things. Where as academics, we're doubting the mind independence or the objectivity of a claim like that. Does that make sense?
Yes, you know, it makes sense to me.
So once you introduce that into an argument, all it takes to destroy that argument then is showing a circumstance where it does fulfill someone's goal to set themselves on fire or to stab or to lie or something like that. That's why just dropping a conditional in like that is not going to give you a sound argument.
Yeah, no, I have responses which I think could really make it so that we more understand like the perspective of why people would use the terms that I have in the past. But it's up to you two if you want to get more of like the, you know, meta-ethical terms on the table or anything like that. Ultimately, your show. But I just want to. But I'm this is keen. This is good.
Kane, also, yeah, I know I kind of took that in a different direction than you went, so sorry about that.
I don't mind. I had no particular plans for the direction anyway, so.
Okay, cool. So, you know, you said, I find tea sweet, and you described iced tea. Sorry, not tea. It has to be iced tea. Okay. Okay, so you find iced tea sweet, and you said that was subjective.
Too sweet, but yes.
Okay, too sweet. Okay, you.
This is how offers are.
Yeah, no, that's okay. It's okay, but yeah. So you've got some proposition about you and about your like or dislike for taste, and you described it as subjective. See, I think a lot of people would describe that as objective.
Oh, it's kind of both.
Yeah,
it's
yeah.
Kind of both. So on one hand, yes, it is objectively true that I find iced tea too sweet. That is an objective fact. It could be false. I could be lying and a huge fan of iced tea and just embarrassed about my Southern heritage, right? But it's truth apt. Now, whether or not iced tea itself is too sweet, that's an impossible question to answer. You'd have to say too sweet for whom, yeah. Right? Or too sweet for what? No objective mind independent fact about the sweetness of iced tea exists. So that's why it gets categorized as subjective. So if I said, I think iced tea is too sweet, okay, I have stated an objective fact about myself, absolutely, but I have not stated an objective fact about iced tea.
Yes, no, I'd understand, like, because they're different propositions. If you was to say that, tea is sweet, or sorry, iced tea is sweet, then that would be a proposition about the properties of iced tea itself, and whether or not you existed to like or dislike its flavor, that would still be true. Would that be correct?
Yeah.
Like, that's still objectively the case. Yeah.
I mean, you're making an objective claim about it, which doesn't really make sense because sweetness is kind of something that you need minds to perceive.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. So when you describe an objective fact about you as an individual, which you're completely correct, if you don't exist, because it's mind dependent, it doesn't exist. And you use the word subjective. See, my intuition would be like, no, that's still an objective fact about you. You get objective facts about subjects. Where subjective comes in, is, as far as my understanding, when it comes to morality, is when you're making distinctly prescriptive claims, not descriptive. So you saying I like iced tea isn't even a moral claim, as far as I understand. If I'm wrong, then do let me know, because part of the parcel here is that I'm just excited to learn from you both, you know. So, and I already have, by the way. So thank you for your time in privately as well.
So one's just a claim about me, and the other is a claim about a property that this thing has. So to convert it into moral language, I could say something like, I think abortion is gross. I think abortion is immoral. I think abortion ought not be done. And all of these would be true insofar as I think those things. I don't. I'm super pro-choice. Or false, right? We can evaluate that. But that's a question about me, not a question about the moral status of abortion. So if you want to drop the I think, right, which just note to anyone who's in school, stop. That's why first person's not allowed in essays, because nobody cares what you think. If you're going to make a claim, make it about the world. You can't construct an argument proving that you think something. All you need to do is assert that you think it, and then you're good. So if we drop that off there, what we have is a claim like abortion is immoral. And now we need to, that's an objective claim about a moral property of abortion. We've now entered the realm of people making these kind of objective claims where abortion has the quality of being moral or immoral. And again, conditionals aren't going to help you here. Hypothetical imperatives aren't going to help you here, because the claim that's being made is about abortion itself.
Yeah, no, I see where you're coming from there completely. The distinction between, like, would I be right in saying that when you say, I think it's immoral for abortion, for instance, you're not making a moral statement at all. You're describing a fact about your state of mind. It's an objective statement.
Yeah, you can. I think it is properly understood that way. Kane, I don't know if you agree or disagree. I said some fairly, not like controversial stuff there, but I unpacked that in an interesting way.
I would not be comfortable saying that I think abortion is immoral is not a moral statement, only because if we're being, you know, pedantic and technical about it, then it is just a statement about, I'm just stating a fact about my own mind, right? But the problem is that people often use language in more or less sloppy ways. And so when somebody says something like, I think abortion is immoral, in the vast majority of contexts, I would be just taking them to be making the claim that abortion is immoral.
Great point.
The other thing here is, it may well be the case that you're talking to somebody who has reflected on these issues and has come down on a moral anti-realist side, and who thinks that, you know, ultimately all there is to morality is just people's opinions. From their point of view, saying, I think abortion is immoral is not really much different from saying abortion is immoral. But I do think that there is a very key distinction between... describing facts about people's minds and then talking about what a person's beliefs may be about. So, you know, when somebody says, I believe that abortion is immoral, there is, yes, a significant difference between describing a fact about their belief, their mind, and then describing what the situation is in the world with respect to abortion. So...
I think that's just a really important, it might just be that no one does listening and it's just me, but I got a feeling it might be some. I think that's so important to stress, and it sounds pedantic and it may even have come across that way, and I apologize if it did, but I do think it's really, really crucial, because the way that I think about morality, even from an intuitive sense when I was coming into it, is that I do see that as a claim that's strictly a fact about the individual. But you're completely right. When people say that, I make the assumption that they're implicitly stating something about abortion itself, like abortion having the property of badness or immoral. And you're right, like that's a completely different claim, and that is a moral claim. But no, fair point. Just because I would talk using words in a certain way, as you're right, most people, well, I don't know if it's most people, but other people don't. And if you go through academia, I'd imagine that you get this kicked out of you quite quickly. And it might be the case that a lot of laymen like me don't get that kicked out. And so there's already a confusion. Like, what are they? This is like where Sam Harris says something like, if you think that putting your hand on a hot stove isn't bad, if you think pain is bad, put your hand on a hot stove. And the reason he thinks he's making a point, I would suggest, is because he's making this confusion with language here, which I've definitely made in the past.
In that case, like, let's say I did put my hand on a hot stove and concluded that it was indeed bad, or wrong or something like that. We have this question, would I be concluding that it was bad for me in that time and in that context? Or would I be deciding that there's something bad about humans placing their hands on hot stoves, right? So I think what's happening here is Kane is exposed to a very different audience than I'm exposed to, and I'm exposed to a very different audience than you're exposed to. So I find that that distinction, while it might seem pedantic, is really important to start with. And I've noticed that a lot of people who engage with ethics I don't want to say layman's, but in like an everyday sense, don't take the time to distinguish between their subjective evaluations of things and their objective claims. And that is the beginning of the line blurring between academic philosophy or academic ethics or whatever you want to call it, and popular philosophy and popular ethics. Because without that distinction, you can argue back and forth endlessly. I've seen it happen about whether or not something like, I think abortion is wrong, is objective or subjective. People are latching on to different parts of the claim. So the best thing to do is just separate them out and go from there. Kane said something really interesting, though, which was about whether or not that was a moral claim. I would want to know, if somebody said, I think abortion is immoral, I would want to know, why do you think that? Right, which kind of strips away the I think, and gets us down to that core question, abortion is immoral. And now that's definitely a moral claim, not a claim about one's mental states or beliefs or anything like that.
With the abortion example, I would agree with you, and that's actually where my head would go. But with the example that you use, where you said that I find cold, was it? I'm forgetting it every time. Cold tea, cold iced tea. Iced tea. Iced tea is good, but I go for iced coffee at the moment. But the statement there, that statement doesn't have an immediate moral emotion that comes through. Like, if you're talking about abortion, I know we're in the realm of morality, but if you're talking about you find something too sweet, I don't actually think you're talking about morality at all. So I think you're making an objective statement about your taste buds, about you as an individual. And so you're right. Like, it's amazing. I think the term is like epistemic bubbles. There does seem to be like different epistemic bubbles. And I'm firmly in a different one to many others, it seems. So this is really refreshing and good.
So maybe I've misunderstood something here. I wouldn't say that the claim that iced tea is sweet is, or indeed I think iced tea is sweet, or I feel iced tea is sweet, or anything like that, is a moral claim either.
Just trying to bring what you were saying back into things, Kane.
Yeah, so basically, if you had it so someone made the statement, I find iced tea sweet, did it, then you have a factual statement about an individual's, you know, taste buds, about a factual statement about what they get in this experience. But if you take that as another example where you go, I think abortion is wrong, technically you could view that in both ways. But because it's loaded, like, abortion is a moral debate in the context of how we talk about it, the intuition isn't to think that they're making a statement, a factual statement about themselves, but actually they are making the more important implicit statement, as you've raised. They're making a statement, abortion has the property of badness, or whatever it might be. So I'm with you on that. That's
big. So for a moral realist, and this is where the clarification on morality that we experienced before was so valuable, where a moral realist is going to come into that is they're going to see that as an objective claim. Well, an error theorist will also see that as an objective claim about abortion having the property of wrongness, right? So then right and wrong are, in these interpretations, objective facts, not, like the iced tea example, subjective ones. Which means they would have to exist mind independently. And I think that's where a lot of the confusion comes in, why I wanted to bring Kane's point back to the four. And Kane, I feel like you make the point better than I do, so it'd be great if you wanted to pick that up. I don't know.
I don't actually know what point you're referring to.
Really?
Yeah.
About the more important... this is my favorite conversation.
I love it.
It's no joke. About the more important distinction being between moral claims and non-moral claims. You said it literally like 10 minutes ago.
Oh, right. Is this the point that if you're making a hypothetically imperative claim, that is not going to generally be viewed as a moral claim? That moral claims are categorical imperatives, so they're not dependent on our desires. Is that the point?
Yes. So yeah. Stephen thought he was a moral realist because he is a materialist, I guess. And
No, not so much a materialism. I mean, so with the moral realism, and I guess you can use this as a springboard, Kane. The reason why I wanted to call myself a moral realist, and I still almost feel like it's the right way to say it because of the way in which so many people I know, it's interesting, but I know that it's not correct. Thanks to you both, you know, letting me know, basically. But I want to say that there are moral facts in reality, but the way in which that's nested in the context of moral philosophy is that that's equivalent to saying that there are categorical imperatives, and I don't think that's true. So I would have to, under that heading, I would have to say I'm not a moral realist. Yeah. But then that puts me in a camp of a load of apathetic people that frustrate the hell out of me. And so I don't like that at all, because they're all the people that I see which largely do fall into, technically, anti-realists, who are doing things in the field where they are actually trying to make moral progress, if you will. They call themselves realist, which is why I've in the past followed that pursuit. But you guys bringing up the fact that actually, because I don't believe in categorical imperatives, I don't think that it's necessarily just wrong to murder or wrong or right that you should fulfill your well-being. I don't see any of this. I am an anti-realist. That's a development for me. And it's interesting because talking about epistemic bubbles, it's like, who am I talking to and how do I communicate? Because the point of communication, of course, is to communicate your ideas. And it's like, if you're talking with one community that uses words in different ways, I guess I feel like I want to just say, use the words as they are used in the context of, you know, how the professionals use it. But I've learned from doing a lot of debates on evolution, that's not very effective. You're better off going down to their level and using the language that they use rather than using the biological language. So that's a question of rhetoric, I guess. That's a question of pragmatism.
I am a bit curious how you're conceiving of what anti-realism is, because it seems to me that it would be kind of absurd for somebody to deny that there's a fact about like the best way of achieving one's goals, where we understand best as something like the most reliable method or something like that. So, you know, we can talk about methods for achieving our goals that are more or less reliable. So if I want to stay warm, I put a coat on, right? Putting a coat on is a good way of staying warm. You know, like when you communicate with the people that you're thinking of as anti-realists, are they denying that there are facts of the matter about that? Because that would seem a bit strange. Or is it that they are kind of skeptics, that they say, well, you know, we just can't know one way or the other? Because I can imagine that being a sort of position that some people might hold, where they say, yeah, I mean, you know, there's a fact of the matter about what the best way of staying warm would be, but we just have no idea what it would be. And in the same way, when it comes to things that are maybe more, would be more commonly seen as, you know, moral, like what's the best way of improving people's happiness in society? Well, we just have no idea about that. You know, that kind of skeptic, I can imagine, like, presenting that as a sort of anti-realism. I mean, is that the kind of person you have in mind when you talk about these apathetic people?
Okay, so... I think, if I'm mistaken, we can come back to this, but I think it would be better obliquely by saying, by describing the type of realists that people that describe themselves as realist, but they're not, for the same reason that I'm not. What happens is they want to say that there are moral facts in the universe, and this relates to how Sam Harris describes with pulling yourself up by the bootstraps. And it's why he uses examples that don't rely on any kind of like syllogism or logic. It's just, look, you won't put your hand on a hot stove. Mm-hmm. And so that's telling you something about something, an argument you already accept. It's an implicit argument you already accept. And I guess from thinking about it, I think the way you could put it is, you don't have the categorical imperative to maximize your well-being and minimize your suffering. And I mean this in like that Bentham sense of, sometimes it might be that suicide is your best option. That still counts under this rubric of the right thing to do according to your own well-being. And we can tap into that because it's reductive, and I appreciate that there's issues with it, but you're going down that fact. So you've got it in this situation where there's no categorical imperative that says that you ought to serve your sovereign, your two sovereign masters, but people do. Everybody you meet are doing everything they can to serve those two masters. All of their actions do it. I actually find that proposition very, very convincing. But it doesn't give you what you want, what the moral philosopher wants, which is the categorical imperative. No, it says that there isn't one, but everyone basically acts as if there is. And that's the bootstraps. And once you have that in place, I don't see why there's any issue with going, yeah, it's absolutely morally wrong for you to enslave someone else. And the reason you would do that is you break it down to the way it affects their well-being individually. And it might be the case that it doesn't affect some people as it does others. And then you have to make an argument that takes into the frame a social contract, because that's interesting. It might be like, you're not bothered by this, but so many people that you live in close proximity are. There's an argument that can be made. It gets very, very complicated, but morality is complicated, that we wouldn't expect anything else. And they're the facts of the matter. So I feel comfortable going up to a religious person and saying, why is it that you want, for example, to use the abortion example, why is it that you want to ban abortion? Well, it is the case that the Bible's true, right? Let's talk about that. And then they might try and push it back to just say, God says so, but I don't accept that. I don't think that's true. So I push them back further and further and further. And basically it comes down to their well-being and trying to do what's right so that they go to heaven, at least in the metaphorical sense, instead of hell in the metaphorical sense. And what I find is a lot of people that are anti-realist, they kind of take this isolation, moral isolationism, which was described in the Midley paper that you sent me. And it's so frustrating, because the people that are intellectually on the same wave as me watch with an apathy where they don't intervene, they don't make these critiques. And if someone says to them, oh, well, actually, I'm doing it because God says so, they stop. They just go, oh, okay, that's your hypothetical imperative, I'm not interested anymore. Whereas the Sam Harris's of the world, me, other people want to go, I want to question that. I'm not taking that at face value because I think it's wrong. I think we have really good reason to think it's wrong. So that's where I see this distinction of realism and anti-realism. But I know that it's not correct. I know that technically I'm an anti-realist, and I thank you both for educating me on that front.
Yeah, so there's a couple of things that I want to say about that. First of all, it is, I think, worth pointing out, look, the mere fact that everybody has the same desires, if indeed that is true. So let's just assume that it is in fact true that everybody is just motivated by pleasure and pain. Everybody's motivated to maximise pleasure and avoid pain. Even if it's the case that like there is a universal desire for something, you're not going to kind of make that actually somehow objective. So, you know, even if it was the case that everybody felt that iced tea was sweet,
That wouldn't make it sweet.
Somehow have the property of sweetness in the world. So I do think that's worth, you know, bearing in mind. I mean, and it may well be the case that what you can do if everybody shares certain values is that will make it a lot easier perhaps to have moral arguments and to have moral debates and to, you know, come to agreements about how to run society. But when philosophers do meta-ethics, we're not really interested in that. You know, we're just interested in the question of well, what are these moral values? What exactly, what is their nature in the world? And so maybe this is, yeah, this is actually one reason why I think this probably, like, you know, when we talk about moral realism and meta-ethics, we're at a bit of a tangent to the kind of concerns that you and many other people have, because, you know, you're ultimately, I guess, mainly interested in engaging in these moral debates and figuring out what's the right thing to do. So you're doing the normative ethics. And, you know, if you have certain desires, and indeed if everybody at some level has the same desire, then we can describe facts about how best to achieve that. But there is another point that I just wanted to address. So I don't know if I should bring that up now or if we want to talk about what I just said, but...
I was just going to give the example. You and I were chatting about this together, and I said, it's so odd that they want to find this thing that's true of all human beings and base their morality around that, because there are lots of things that are true about all human beings, but we don't try to derive morality from that. Like, for example, we all have skin. I don't conclude then, it's good to have skin. it's just a fact, right? And this is where that is ought gap, like, really produces itself, is like, okay, yes, it is true that we all have skin. If you want to go on then to say that that's good, now we have a problem. We all require oxygen. That's also universally true about human beings. So I don't understand the quest for, like, some claim that's true about all human beings. Even if you were able to find that and prove that it was true for all human beings, it wouldn't tell us anything about whether that was right or wrong.
I completely agree. So much so with both of you that I think I may have miscommunicated, because it's not a position of everybody agrees with X, therefore X is somehow true, right? Everybody thinks that slavery is wrong. Let's say, we know that's not true, but let's just say that's the case. Therefore, slavery has the property of wrongness. No, it's not that. Although, to be clear, I'm not sure what Harris is doing, and I can't speak for other people. I think they might be doing things like this. But the egoist position that I'm taking, and it's strictly egoist, it's just my well-being. That's it. But the reason why you can come up with a social contract which regulates things is that we happen to all be members of the same species, a social species. And so while we will differ in slight details and to different gradients on these axioms, if you will, we won't on some of them. You may be able to get some cases where it is tough luck. Your objective, you know, what you should do is in conflict with so many others. You're just going to get turfed out. As sad, or it's not sad because it's not objectively sad. So that's more of the point on there. It is strictly in an ego sense, but yeah.
So I certainly didn't mean to interpret your position as claiming that, okay, if everybody agrees with X, then X is true. I guess I was just wanting to really emphasize the point that it's not enough to make a claim of objective value to say, well, like, everybody desires X, so, you know, that X is valuable or anything like that.
Although I think Mill tried to write a proof for happiness. Have you seen that? He tried to write an actual proof of happiness being the only good.
Well, yeah, I read...
Or maybe it's desire, either way. Yeah, it's very silly.
I guess brings me on to what was the other thing that I wanted to address about what you said a while ago when I said there were two things. Because I think you moved quite quickly over something that I think is a really important point that doesn't seem to me to get addressed that often. When you were talking about how, okay, we can kind of pull ourselves up by the bootstraps. This is the sort of Harris view that, okay, everybody, when they put their hand on a hot stove, they feel pain, right? And the pain is bad. Obviously it is. I can put my hand on the stove. I feel pain. I don't like it. It's, you know, causes suffering, whatever. Pretty much everyone's going to have the same reaction. I mean, that's kind of built into the very idea of pain. Well, maybe not, because there are, like, masochists and stuff. So, but
you know, you switch it for suffering, and then suffering necessarily defines it in such a way.
Pain
is actually good sometimes. You know, if they're kinky.
Let's assume that that we do in fact have some way of identifying something that is an objective value. So let's say we could show that it is actually objectively that suffering is objectively bad. The problem is that that doesn't actually give you anything resembling a moral system. You don't get anything, any kind of ought claim from that. And the reason is, even once you've identified what the values are, you've still got to address an additional question of how you act with respect to those values. And here's a classic sort of debate, right? On the one hand, you've got the consequentialist who says, well, the thing that we should do with whatever it is we value is just maximize it. So you should perform whatever actions you can to maximize the thing that's valuable. So if we value, you know, happiness, then we should just act so as to maximize happiness, even if that means imposing unhappiness on some people.
The example that Michael Sandel uses, and I'm sure others have used it, is can we please just hypothetically, can we be Romans and we throw Christians to the animals in the ring? Can we do that? Okay, that's good.
So that's one kind of view is, all right, just promote, maximize the value. But then another kind of view would be, well, what you ought to do with respect to the way you ought to act with respect to these values is to kind of honor them. If we say value, autonomy and liberty, where that kind of means allowing people to make their own decisions and, you know, not interfering with them and so on. Somebody who wants to honor that value would say, like, you can't interfere with somebody else's liberty, right? Even if that would maximize liberty for other people overall. Or if we take happiness as the value, somebody who wants to honor that would say, no, you can't impose unhappiness on somebody, even if that would maximize happiness overall. Mm. And so I think this is something that's, like, you kind of touched on this when you said, oh, well, you know, there's this big moral debate and, you know, the social contract and all of that. But it's like, well, actually, even if you establish that there are these objective values, even if we were to have them somehow built into the furniture of the world, you're still not going to get objective ought claims. There is a distinction, I think, between like
honoring
goodness.
Maximizing.
Well, no, not that. Sorry. Well, there is a distinction there, but there's also a distinction between moral goodness and what you ought to do. And you know, the kind of position that certainly both me and Cole would have is that, we're anti-realist about both. We don't think that there are either of those claims are, you know, somehow built into the world. But, you know, even if you get the objective value, you've still got a lot of work to show that there's an objective ought claim. And I don't
Can
think
I,
there's a few people, you know, certainly Sam Harris, I don't think even tries to do that work.
I would agree with you, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, one thing I have learned, and I like Sam Harris, I've said so before, and I actually do find him very, very valuable still. But the more and more I've learned about moral philosophy, the more and more I've realized that he either doesn't understand it and hasn't read it, or potentially I'm still in my learning curve and I'm mistaken. But he's not. Yeah, the more I learn, the more I'm not impressed by what he's done in this sphere. But I really do think that he's hitting on something that's important. I don't think I've ever really considered what you just said there, Kane. So I just want to rephrase it back to you to understand that I've got it correct. Are you basically saying that you've got you've got this ought distinction, which is predicated on you as an individual and, you know, your hypothetical imperatives? If you've got a hypothetical imperative, as you said, these ought statements have no issue whatsoever. Or even if you had a categorical imperative, you can use oughts because you get an ought from an ought, no problem whatsoever. Is it what you're saying is, if you had like this moral law that said it is wrong to murder, you still need a mapping between you as an individual and that before you can start making ought statements? because it doesn't just come just out of nowhere. That seems to be what I got from that. And that strikes me as probably correct. Like, yeah, it doesn't, it means nothing. It's just a fart in the wind. If it's just, it's wrong to murder and you don't have any kind of tether to it, then yeah, I can't make an ought statement to you.
So I guess that might be one way to put it. When you say you need a mapping, I think that what you are still going to need is some theory telling you, okay, it's wrong to murder, so there's this property of wrongness built into murder. But what do I do now, right? I mean, do I act so as to ensure that this property is minimized everywhere, or do I act so as to make sure that I personally never bring it about? I mean, there's a distinction there, and it's like, in order to get any kind of ought claim about like what I ought to do, I mean, I guess you can say, well, you ought not to murder. But actually, you don't get that, because if you think that the thing to do is to maximize what you value or to minimize what you disvalue, you know, minimize what you think is bad, then there are situations where actually you should murder.
I was thinking about capital punishment of murderers, for example, in circumstance, right? So if you want to maximize not murdering, that might require you to murder someone, namely a murderer, right? Like a serial killer. So I don't know, you're a cop, you're chasing somebody, they're a serial killer. Maximizing not murdering would mean shooting that guy. Whereas honoring not murdering would mean not shooting that guy. Right. Mm-hmm. So even if you do have
this objective moral fact,
it's still not clear what you should do with that.
I really like that, because you can almost apply that as a reductio. I need to play with this more in my head, actually. As I said, that is the first time I've properly considered that. So you could, if someone says to you, the reason it's wrong to murder is because God says so, and they do it in this divine command theory kind of way, and it's like an edict, it's a rule in the universe, that doesn't bridge. Like, you can do a reductio where you go, okay, let's just say that's true. Why ought I obey it? And you're going to, I would argue, you're probably going to be in a nest that in that egoistic dichotomy that I use, or they're going to have to give you some reason of nesting it, because it's not enough for it just to be some law in the universe. That gives me a lot of food for thought.
You should follow it. How you follow it isn't clear at all.
Definitely the how, but also just I can't give you the ought statement unless, as you said, you can't get an ought from an ought. So sorry, you can't get an ought from an is. So you'd have to. Yeah, that's an interesting one. I'm gonna have to digest.
I still think that we've missed the point that I really wanted Kane to make. So I'm just gonna go ahead and make it, because like we've gone back and we're playing in this realm of moral realists, right? And you have wanted to. Identify as a moral realist. And Kane and I found it striking because your reason for wanting to be a moral realist was empirical facts, not about morality, but about what best suits our outcome, at which point Kane and I are going to say, well, those just aren't even moral claims. Those are just claims about cause and effect, or likely outcomes, or those sorts of things. There's no moral claim in saying, like, well, if let's say you're advocating for slavery and you point out that, well, most people don't want that, and that's likely to get you killed or imprisoned if you start enslaving people, so you shouldn't do that because you don't want to be killed or enslaved or imprisoned. Your argument there is not made up of objective moral facts. Your argument there is made up entirely of empirical facts just about how the world is. None of those claims are moral claims. The fact that society doesn't like it much, or your society doesn't like it much, is just an empirical claim. There's no moral claim there. The fact that it's likely to land you in jail or killed by the person you've tried to enslave. Again, empirical claim. All your hypothetical imperatives won't add up to a moral claim. You're still not being a moral realist. You're being a realist about society or likely outcomes. You're just not making moral claims at all, or engaging with ethics. And it seems inappropriate to call you a moral realist, whereas you actually just seem to be like a material realist or something like that. I don't know if Cain has a better name for that behavior or that sort of thing than I do. I feel like you said it at one point, but
I'm not sure what the name for it would be. I don't think you have to be a materialist even in order to make in order to endorse.
Yeah, I'm just trying to categorize it.
I'm not a materialist, and I'm perfectly happy with people having desires and hypothetical imperatives about best means to realize those desires.
Would that? Yeah, I mean,
moral claims or moral facts.
Yeah. If I rephrase what the observation seems to be from you both, and you just tell me if I'm getting this succinctly correct, you think that I'm calling hypothetical imperatives moral facts and then calling myself a realist. That's essentially what I'm doing.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm
okay with that. Do you think that's basically it, Cain, or?
Well, not necessarily, because it seemed like you included an additional claim, which is that all people universally have at bottom the same kind of motivational structure, which therefore makes, I guess that makes it a lot more clear how you might see that as a kind of realism, because there's going to be a sense in which there are certain hypothetical imperatives which hold universally for everyone.
I see what you mean. Yeah. You
know, so let me
clarify that then to make that more clear. It is strictly just the individual. That's it. So it is as I described it, and it seems to be the way that you're getting it. And that is that I'm describing certain hypothetical imperatives as moral imperatives, and I totally get that. That's just not cool with the way in which things are cashed out in the literature. Matt Dillahunty says something quite important in morality, and I think I'm just going to have to follow suit. I think it's important. I don't think I actually care whether or not I call it morality anymore. Call it morality if you want, call it not. I think that there's a really good argument to be made here, because I think it is true. It's just as much true that you're born with a hand, or you're born finding sweet iced tea good, if you see what I mean. Like, all of these facts about you, it's also just a fact that you're born with these bootstraps of wanting to avoid suffering and maximize pleasure. I don't care if we call that morality, but I understand that, strictly speaking, nope, I'm an anti-realist. I don't believe categorical imperatives exist, but I still think there's a really big fight to be had. And I get frustrated by the fact that it seems like the more and more someone is in tune with the literature of morality, the more and more apathetic they become, the more and more moral isolation that you see that was expressed with frustration by Migley that I share. It's really frustrating. And then you see someone like Sam Harris come out, and you see some people come out, and they actually are touching on this thing here. And you're following them all the way, and some people might follow them all the way because there's nothing out there like what I'm expressing, so far as I can tell. It seems like an odd position. But because I think a lot of people have this kind of perspective of morality, and that's why they want to talk about it being objective in that sense. Just to slightly pivot, actually, because I realize I'm missing a touch. With the hypothetical imperatives, it's like, what's the difference between a normal hypothetical imperative and a, you know, moral hypothetical imperative? And so far as I can tell, it's just when the hypothetical imperative is making statements about what you should and shouldn't do to other people, or shouldn't do to other things. And then that's it. So I do get the frustration of like, well, that's not morality. You're just talking about hypothetical imperatives. And I'm with you. I get it. As far as using the normal language, yeah, like, I'm an anti-realist. It's hypothetical imperatives all the way down. The only difference might be is that I won't take people at their face value when they say God says so. I go, nope, that's not where your bedrock is. That's not where your foundation is.
But again, keep, we don't do that.
Okay, yeah, because that was based on the prior conversation we had where you said that you would take it at face value. But okay, fair enough.
And I clarified face value.
I mean, I do just want to say, I don't think I I'm not sure what the distinction would be either between, say, moral hypothetical imperatives and non-moral hypothetical imperatives. I think that what I might say is, well, you know, if a hypothetical imperative follows from a categorical imperative, then it's going to be part of a moral system. But, you know, so if I make a hypothetical imperative about how your behavior affects other people, I might say something like, look, if you want to be well liked by your community, you ought not to go around smashing people's windows. And the ought here would follow from your desire to be well liked and the fact that smashing people's windows is a very effective means of getting people to dislike you. Now that I wouldn't see as being moral. It has to do with your interactions with other people, but because the concern there is just what is the best means of fulfilling my desire, and what where morality comes in is when you're going to be making claims about what you ought to do independently of your desires. So it's like you ought not to smash people's windows, like regardless of how it might benefit you or how you might feel about it or what you desire. That's their property. So don't do that.
I want to jump in if that's okay, Kane, if you're done making your point.
I think so.
I want to suggest something very quickly, which is that it's very odd if you have a moral system that, I mean, and this is what a moral system built entirely out of hypothetical imperatives would entail. You should always do whatever you want to do. That's what you end up with at bottom if you have a series of it's a conditional, and that's the only guide you have to whether or not you should do something. All you're saying is you should always do what you want to do, and that's not a moral system.
I don't think so.
If you want to be well liked by people, then you shouldn't smash windows. Okay, well, you shouldn't smash windows, but you add all these together, right? So you've got all these hypotheticals based on what you do or do not want, and all you're actually saying is you should do what you want to do and not do what you don't want to do. And that's not a moral system at all.
Yeah, so again, with the Matt Dillahunty response, I'm happy to just go, okay, call it whatever you want. If that's not morality, it's not morality, but I still think that's...
I'm not sure I agree. I think that what you're missing here is that people can want things that are not actually in line with what their interests are because they may have faulty information. So, I mean, I might say, oh, I'm thirsty. I want to have a drink out of this cup. Oops, I forgot that I put the cyanide in it. You know? I do want to have a drink out of the cup. But, you know, I think that we probably... So, you'd want to say that actually, there are certain, I guess, hypothetical imperatives that might be true of you, but that you are unaware of.
I think that's most certainly true. Yeah.
I think the critique I was trying to offer is more along the lines of, this might take a minute. I was trying to be quick, and I shouldn't try to cut corners. My bad. My favorite critique of Aristotelian virtue ethics has nothing to do with how virtue ethics is presented or it as an ethical system. My favorite critique is that it doesn't tell you what you should do to other people. It's not other regarding. It's all inward, right? That entire system is about making you, the best you can be. I don't think that is a great moral system. I don't think that's a great system of any sort. Whereas all other moral systems that I'm aware of are other regarding. They tell you how you should treat other people. Mm-hmm. Now, if you have a moral system built entirely out of your own desires, right, and maximizing your own desires, you don't have an other regarding system either. You have an entirely self-regarding system that effectively says you should do in the way that best suits your outcomes exactly what you want to do. And that, in the same way that Aristotelian virtue ethics leaves me really unsatisfied, because it's not other regarding, the thing you've presented leaves me really unsatisfied because it is in no way other regarding. And we, most of us want
by proxy
systems to be other regarding. I hope that helps.
No, I see where you're coming from. But because you're in a society, you're a member of a social species, and you do have this social contract, the illusion is that it's predicated on something that is for the whole. So you get people going, it's humanism, it's well-being, and then their actions are incredibly hypocritical with that position. My hypothesis is that they're mistaken in what it's actually about. It's actually about them as personal individuals, but it manifests in a social species as it being something that's, funny enough, taking on this like quasi-categorical imperative, and it's not. It is strictly about the individual, and this is why you would have, to me, that hypothesis, I wouldn't call it a theory, of course, but the hypothesis there makes sense of a lot of things that otherwise just seems like an enormous amount of cognitive dissonance and hypocrisy. So that's another reason why I think this is probably the case, and I think it's true. But yeah, the point that you lay there is that's fair. Like, it does come down, you know, to the individual.
Well,
it's a selfish thing.
Me off.
yeah. Yeah, sorry. Go.
Can I share? And it was totally fine. With regard to people just throwing up their hands and saying, like, fine, you don't want to call it morality, call it something else, whatever. Like, these are good questions. And from your perspective, you see us as largely apathetic. I don't think we're being apathetic. I think we're being very careful because we understand that this is a really important thing that we're working on. So I both Kane and I have never seen an error theorist just be like, I don't care, do whatever you want. There is no such thing.
Yeah, it's not like, so the criticism isn't like
let's
that.
Let's just burn it all down, right?
Yeah.
Or let's not do anything. Let's just all sit at home and
beds. Okay, cool. You know, okay, fair enough. That's an important point that you raise. Let me try and explain the apathy from another angle. So you see a culture. Take, for example, what's actually happening in the Middle East, where, and in Africa, where they are cutting the clitoris off females at birth.
Yeah.
Now, that inspires in me moral outrage. And the reason it does, because you effectively could just go, well, there's nothing wrong with that. There's no law that says that's wrong. There's no law to say that women should have equal rights. There's no law for any of this stuff.
I don't know where law came from. That's okay.
But law is in categorical imperative, right? Law in categorical imperative. And so if you take like the strict position, you can just go, or the anti-realist position, and you just state it clearly. You just go, yeah, there's nothing to say that that's right and the West has got it wrong. I'm going to go have a drink. That's the kind of apathy I'm talking about. Whereas someone like me and someone like Harris would go in there and say, you know, why is it that you're doing this? And then they would give their propositions. And you could do it as an anti-realist as well. I am an anti-realist by these definitions, right? You can go in there and do that, and you can question why they're doing it. And they go, because it is the case that Allah exists. It is the case that Allah inspired Muhammad in the construction of the Quran and the Hadith. And it is the case that this explicitly states, you know, women just aren't to be trusted with their lustful blah, blah, blah. So you have to cut off the clitoris at birth. And you could take that at face value and go, that's their culture, which is this isolationist position, which is infuriating. It's so apathetic. And it's a form of bigotry in my mind. Like, I don't like that at all. Whereas you could question it further and go, well, why do you care about the Quran being true? And you might get this position of that's where the buck stops. That's just where it is. That's that law. But as actually what Kane was saying earlier about there being this rule or this categorical imperative, that's not enough. You have to map why you ought to care about it at all. And if you keep pushing it, you'll get down because they're a member of a social, they're an individual. You're gonna push that down into suffering and well-being. And so you could say, the reason you've got to this position of slicing a part of the genitalia away from your daughter is because you have this fact about the world that's not true, the Quran. And there's rather than accepting that at face value and just go, okay, conversation over, you can question that and go further. And if you can convince them that the Quran is not true, they stop doing it. And this is the same.
I want to clarify something really quickly.
Yeah, sure.
I am an Arab woman. And I have family of various religious beliefs. There is nothing in Islam that prescribes female circumcision or female genital mutilation. It is entirely a cultural thing. And I realize me saying it that way is kind of exactly what you're talking about. But just for clarity's sake, that is not, it's really not common in Islam. It's more of a regional cultural
thing. Sure, you can kind of, like, so if I could, it's a different topic and I'm not prepared with the facts and stuff to be able to dispute that. Okay. So don't worry
they
about
do,
it. Just,
they do,
just
however, really mutilate some boy dicks.
Definitely. Yeah. I've never met
a Muslim. In Islam.
Absolutely. In any case, the point I was trying to make is in relevance to, you have just a cultural difference. It doesn't matter if it's cultural per se as in the Quran and religion or whether or not it's just a cultural difference. You see something that's happening that is at odds of personal well-being, and then you can go in there and you can have these kind of conversations, or you can do the isolationist perspective and just go hands off. And that's what's appealing about Sam Harris, about those kind of views, is that
there's a third option.
Yeah, of course there's more options, but you'd be gone.
Or not. I see him like engaged, leaning forward. But maybe his screen just froze that way.
No, I mean, if you want to say the third option, you can go ahead and then I can come back
to
the
others. Okay, so I'm going to express a concern now, and it's weird to express this concern about female circumcision. I'm opposed to it. I'm opposed to male circumcision. I think both should be illegal for reasons completely outside of this conversation. But just for, you know, historical record, I am opposed to those. But if I see somebody saying, all right, circumcision of anyone is just wrong. It's just wrong, and we need the moral system that allows us to go in there and stop that. I'm going to be reluctant to just immediately side with them and their moral system, because that's exactly what the people who are circumcising people believe. Like, there's a fact of the matter about this, and I've just either got to do it or not do it. And I'm like, ooh, careful. And this is what I meant about, I think you're perceiving caution as apathy. So I don't want any more girls to have their genitals mutilated. I don't like that. But I also don't want to assume I'm just right about it. Because assuming I'm just right about it leads to assumptions about me being just right about lots and lots of things. Mm-hmm. Right. So, I mean, I can imagine situations where an adult woman comes to believe in this ritual practice for whatever reason, and she wants to have it done. So does my Western view then of like, no, your clitoris is super important. It's great. Let me tell you how great it is. You should have the same values I do, which is valuing the fuck out of your clitoris. That's a very important part. I'm hesitant to go in and say my values just automatically override your values. Again, we're not talking about children. We're not talking about that. I'm hesitant of anything that just gives me license to go in by fiat and impose my values on other people. I think Cain makes a really good example here. You and I, Stephen, are both vegetarians. And it just seems like the obvious right thing to do. Cain is not a vegetarian. And it might seem obviously right to me, and I know I've presented to him all my reasons for being a vegetarian. And they have all failed to persuade him. Because at a certain level where I'm operating just based on my personal prerogative and values, and he doesn't particularly care about those things. I'm scared of any system that says I have the right to go in and reorganize or reassign his values.
I'm not saying that though. Like, that's really important
but
to get down.
Harris
I'm not.
And the rest of them are.
He's saying there's a conversation to be had. He's saying that if you go in there and you go, I know that you value well-being, let's have a discussion. Progress can be made, even if it's just factual progress in that sense. Maybe. Whereas, can you name a moral philosopher that's strictly anti-realist and like takes that is going in and trying to convince them not to mutilate the genitalia of children?
Pretty much every answer.
I mean,
is.
I don't.
But like a popular one.
Mackie, Aya. Who are the popular
ones? I don't
think
Maggie's alive.
Oh, I'm naming dead people because they are the popular... Like, there aren't really popular living philosophers. So, you know,
I mean,
name a popular living philosopher
I mean,
who's
I
doing this thing is always going to go nowhere. But okay, what was I saying? So, first of all, right, I mean... Look, anti-realists can have like really strong moral commitments. I mean, and like many of them do. Also, it's just worth pointing out, like you could be a realist who just doesn't give a shit, right? Like you could believe there are objective facts and that, you know, there's objective facts about what you ought to do, but just not care about it. So the kind of apathy that you describe might just be a sort of psychological thing. You could even be a moral philosopher who is a realist who like studies the right ethical system, but then just not care. You could just be like, yep, I think that vegetarianism is morally required. I think it is an objective fact. And here's my reasons why. I don't care. I'm going to carry on eating meat. But you could do that. So with respect to your question about like anti-realist philosophers, I mean, seriously, pretty much all of them will be willing to engage, at least engage in moral discussions, and you know, they will be prepared to pass judgment on other societies and so on. That's definitely not something that is unique to realists.
So if they was to meet someone that says that it finishes at a belief in God, you're saying that they will go in there and critique that and try and convince them that that's not actually where it is. It goes further back to their well-being, or it goes to something else. Like, that's the kind of positions they're pushing through. Or is that just like the Harrises of the world, or, you know, various other utilitarians that are out there?
Well, I can't say because all of them would do, but I can say if somebody was to make the claim that they ought to do something because it is prescribed by God, I mean, certainly most of the anti-realists that I know would probably begin by just questioning what the grounds are for believing in God. I mean, actually, well, I mentioned Mackie. Mackie is also very well known for his arguments for atheism. So you know, so anybody who tries to justify an ethical position on the grounds that it's what God says, he would say that's just like, you know, it's a false presupposition, and you know, false beliefs probably not something you want.
Because
these
are empirical
facts. Well, that's something else that's worth flagging up, actually. If you have it so that Sam Harris is the person who's out there, you know, arguing for this, and it just turns out that he's getting the front page, and actually there's plenty of people that don't hold that, you know, strictly and explicitly an anti-realist position that are doing the same, but they don't get on the front page. It might explain why there's this, like, perception that I've fallen guilty into, you know? So... That might explain it, because Sam Harris is very popular, and as for why, I don't know whether it's piggybacking off the fact that he had the atheist books first and then went for it. Probably is.
I have a different theory, but Kane had something he really wanted to say.
Well, no, yeah, sorry. Yeah. You, Cole, presented this kind of caution about imposing your values on other people, and I mean, I think that's to some degree quite reasonable, and I imagine, you know, even many realists would also have similar caution. But when you would, I just want to make sure that doesn't come across as being in any way like entailed by anti-realism. And just as a very clear illustration of this, I actually think that if you are a vegetarian or vegan for moral reasons, if you think that animals count, then you absolutely should be trying to impose that on me. You should be trying. Actually, I'm not really the one you should be concerned about because I don't really eat that much meat anyway. For other reasons that have nothing to do with animals. But, you know, I think you should be trying to abolish animal agriculture. I'm an anti-realist, and I'm not even a vegan or vegetarian. At least I certainly don't care about animals. But if you do care about animals, then...
Apart from human.
Oh, yeah.
We've both talked about that.
But, you know, so I would say that, yes, caution is important, but this idea, let's not take the caution too far, you know, because I absolutely would want to say, like, slavery, no, you're just not allowed to do that. And I think that we should take steps to prevent you by force from doing that if you try to. And it may be that, like, if it's happening in another country, it's just not practical to intervene because, you know, going to war has all sorts of bad consequences. But that's something I'm quite happy to impose my values on others. And
isn't that a different distinction, though?
I was definitely trying to draw a very different distinction. The concern I was trying to express is with becoming confident as a moral realist. Becoming confident that you have found the system that works and then going around with that and imposing that system on other people. The danger there is not doing something wrong necessarily or anything like that. It's that your system doesn't work and you have accepted your system as completely true. So we should be careful when developing these systems and trusting them. We should be careful with, like, Sam Harris is just married to his idea. That's just what it is. He's got it. He's got it figured out with science or whatever. And he's right. And that doesn't mean doing his thing. We've got, again, that moral landscape, because I get it. There are peaks and valleys, although I don't think that makes a lot of sense when you investigate it. But all the same, if you think you are right, if you are that convinced that you are right, there's nothing that is going to disprove your position. It's the same trap that religious people get stuck in, right? And this is the worst with regard to ethics, when you just look at something and you're like, no, that is wrong. I am going to go and stop it.
You get like what you could call like
you're overconfident. Yeah.
Well, you get like an imperialist attitude, basically.
I mean,
we've got the right answer, and we're coming to give you the right answer.
Yeah.
If I could just very quickly reply to both of those elements, just for the clarity's sake of it, with you, Kane, where you're saying that if you're convinced of a proposition, you should absolutely go out there and try and make the world according to the proposition that you're convinced of. So if you're convinced of veganism, go out there and try and make it so that the world becomes vegan. I'm not even concerned about convincing you. I actually just want to claim authority over you because I think that this is such a moral imperative to me. And so I'm doing it that way. The second way is that I want to convince you that that's something that you want as well, and that you might be mistaken in your position. There might be cognitive dissonance, or there might be certain facts that you're not privy to, or something like that. Like, so it seems to be two different ways that we could approach that. At least one of them is like an imperial kind of position. I'm going to basically make it so that you can't have meat without everyone thinking blah blah blah. Or two, I'm going to try and convince you that that's more cohesive with actually the dispositions that you have. But when it comes to, and then on the flip side, when it comes to trying to convince people that they're mistaken in whatever position they have, say it was male genital mutilation, for example, for explicitly religious reasons, which you get in Judaism as well, it's not about going in there and going, I have the answer. It's more about like, there's a debate to be had here. And it's like, let's just say that they bring up arguments that are to do with health, because there's some arguments for it. I don't think they're anywhere near sufficient, but there is some. There's a conversation to be had there where it's in relation to something. It's more about wanting to have these conversations rather than just going, using this isolationist approach. But I also hear what you're both saying, that that's not something that's unique to anti-realists, even though that's a perspective that, or a perception that I have, and I think others have. And it would explain why it's so appealing to see someone come out and push the position that Sam has. And the last thing I will say here is that I will defend Sam. I don't think he's saying he has the answer. I think what he's saying is that there is right and wrong answers, and that he's tired of like the ethicist on Obama's administration, for example, when she said to him in the book, if I can recall correctly, essentially he came up with some reductio where he basically said, what if we met a culture that was taking out the eye of every other third person because they had some scripture that said every third should walk in blind? Should we at all, you know, try and have any kind of moral conversation there? And she said no, because she's probably referring to this there's no categorical imperative against it. And so to him it's like this shell shock of what the hell's going on here. I don't know if that adds a bit more to the table
just,
or whatnot.
To clarify my position in light of the two options you raised there. So to be absolutely clear, if I cared about animals, I would absolutely be an imperialist about it, the way that you phrased it, right? So, you know, and I certainly don't see any kind of necessary connection between like anti-realism and perhaps the kind of more cautious approach you're describing.
I accept that. Yeah. I think that's fair. I accept that point.
So, what was the other thing? Oh yeah, it was about this woman. I don't recall the specifics of what this woman said. So I don't want to put words into her mouth, but I would think that if we're dealing with that kind of moral relativism, or that kind of isolationism, where we're saying no, we shouldn't pass judgment on other cultures, like that seems itself to follow from a categorical imperative. In fact, it may follow from a kind of realist position, because if you think it is just a fact that we ought not to judge other cultures, you can say that as a realist, right? I mean, it may be an objective fact that we ought not to do that, and it's not really, I mean, it's certainly not clear where else is the justification for not engaging in moral discourse going to come from. In fact, I'd want to say, you know, okay, if you are an anti-realist, like, what's the issue? What's the issue with talking to people from other cultures? Where would the ban on that come from, I guess?
Yeah, if I don't believe moral facts exist, then I'm not going to try and convince you of it. For the same reason I wouldn't try and convince you of God.
About moral
I know I'm just trying to explain like where that mentality might come from.
Well, first of all, I don't know that this woman was a philosopher of any sort. There are different ways to be an ethicist or appointed to that position. She may have been an attorney or something like that prior to being appointed to that position. I also don't know the full context of what she said there, but I do know that she was saying it as somebody in politics having to make a choice about America's actions with regard to this other country. And she may have had anti-imperialist concerns or something like that. I don't know what it, yeah, neither Kane nor I know, nor
no, it
you.
Was, it was, no, it was in his book and it's Sam's account, and it was a private conversation rather than public. So, no, I totally get it. I was just using it as an example. But
none of that strikes me as anti-realist. And I think what Kane was really trying to hammer home there was, I'm baffled that one would take a position like hers and conclude that she was an anti-realist because, I mean, if you want it to be a free-for-all for anti-realists, I'm going to get involved all the time. It's never wrong for me to get involved. It's never wrong for me to have a conversation. It's never wrong for me to do anything, because there's no such thing as wrong. If I see something I don't like, or that I think is destructive to the planet, or humans I care about, or anything like that, I'm going to hella get involved. It would require, like, again, from my perspective, it would require somebody be a moral realist and to have some sort of tenet like never interfere with other cultures to get to her position. That's the only way I can see getting to that position is through realism, where your highest priority is sustaining culture, sustaining cultural diversity, not a policy of non-interference or something like that. You have to have something to get you to that point, and anti-realism is not going to get you there.
I mean, I think an anti-realist probably could just, I don't know, take it as like a fundamental value or something, but it would be, I think it would be an odd, yeah, it seems like it would be an odd position, because it's like, well, like, why would you hold that as a fundamental value? I mean, it certainly isn't like, if you say, well, I'm just not going to engage in moral discourse with anybody because moral discourse doesn't interest me or something like that, then, you know, I can totally see an anti-realist taking that kind of position. But why would you think, I engage in like moral interactions, but only with people in this culture? I mean, maybe I'm underestimating the degree of like tribalism that exists.
Well, one way that I could see it from my head here, it would be if you've got moral realists saying that there are moral facts in the universe, and then you have, you know, an anti-realist that's saying that there is no moral facts in the universe, wouldn't like the contrapositive of that essentially be, there's no way in which I can tell someone what they ought to do or ought not to do?
No, because
isn't that a position that some
facts?
Sorry, say again.
No, because we still have full access to empirical facts, and
but if there's no moral facts, if there's no moral facts, and you're trying to make a moral statement, doesn't that just like, it's basically you can't play tennis because there is no net?
Well, there are lots of ways, I think, of engaging in moral debate and coming to moral conclusions, even in the absence of moral facts. And I mean, I think we've actually kind of covered a lot of this already, really. I mean, it's so the fact that some people will make moral claims on the basis of false presuppositions, like the person who says, I ought to do this because it's what God requires. We can have a debate about those factual matters, and that may change people's moral views. And you know, more generally, we can all specify things that we desire, and we can sort of think, like, as a society, okay, how should we act so as to best achieve those desires? And then we can kind of moralize that, right? I think that the language of morality is a very useful fiction for, I don't think there are moral facts. I think it's a very useful fiction for like expressing kind of social rules that we come up with for the purposes of promoting cooperation and so on. And I mean, so like, in the same way, and well, maybe it's not exactly the same, but look, we don't always speak the truth. There are lots of different reasons why we might want to say things that are false. Like, even if you're doing science, there are good reasons to say things that are false, because, you know, I might be modeling a star, and it turns out to be a lot simpler to model the star as being composed of an ideal gas, even though I know that there is no ideal gas in the real world. Or when I'm sending a probe to Pluto, I might do the calculations using Newtonian mechanics, even though I know that that's been displaced in terms of it, the way that it describes the underlying structure of space-time, it's wrong. These falsehoods can be really useful. Now, I think that moral discourse is very useful, because one of the things that pretty much all of us want is we want a relatively stable society. We want people to behave in regular ways, because that helps us to achieve our goals. You know, if I run a shop, I want to be able to rely on people entering the shop to behave in regular ways, and, you know, not to just smash things up and so on. We also want to have means of coming to compromises when our goals conflict.
Did he freeze up for you? Yeah, he froze up for me too.
Oh dear.
Can we Can we agree that that was objectively bad? He's back.
Okay. I don't know when you. How much did you miss there? Was that
five seconds?
Okay. So yeah, I was just saying. You know, we want to come to ways of, you know, coming to agreements when our goals conflict. And you know, I think moral discourse is just a sort of useful way of I guess, quickly summarizing rules and of engaging in persuasion with other people. So I don't know if that, does that sort of answer the concern there? Does that make sense?
This is why I keep saying that these are empirical claims empirical claims rather than moral claims, right? Because, all right, okay, so I'll be America's ethicist instead of that other lady. And Sam Harris can come to me and say, what if I told you there's a culture that was scooping out the eyes of children because their religious text told them that that was what they ought to be doing? So built into that is a claim that that religious text is accurate or based on more than like the whim of a crazy shaman or something like that. So now I get to have, without any moral language or without any kind of objective morality, I get to have this lovely conversation about something that is an objective fact, whether or not that book is accurate, whether or not that book is true, whether or not following that book is in the interests of this society. There are lots of, everything that you as a like pseudo realist, I don't know what to call you anymore, or Harris as a realist, everything you want to do, you still get to do as an anti-realist because every move that that makes is an empirical matter, right? With regard to circumcision, right? Which is prescribed, male circumcision, which is prescribed by the Bible. Mm-hmm. The first thing I'm going to do there, and the first thing hopefully any reasonable person is going to do there, is say, okay, how do we know that Bible's real? Why should we take that as fact? What's your evidence for it? And if you can't provide me good reasons for accepting what that book tells you, you need to stop mutilating dicks. Like the
end. What if it? Yeah. So if the book says
you're basing it on a false belief, which is that that book is real.
So what if the book says take it on faith?
Sorry.
No, I was just going to say, what if the book says take it on faith, and that's why they're going with it. You know, like if you have a lot of conversations with religious people from many sects, when you get very uncomfortable, a lot of them will just appeal to faith. And that's a conversation stopper.
Yeah, The Bible does say, well, it says a lot of things that are contradictory. There are bits of it that say, take it on faith. Faith in itself is virtuous, right? But you still say, okay, why believe that that book is an accurate representation of the world or reality or accurately reports moral facts or anything like that? I, as an error theorist, am more free to say, okay, this book asserts the existence of objective moral facts, and I have a problem with the veracity of this book. That's it. Like, okay, take it on faith, but that's coming. You're just begging the question.
I do want to point
out, could you,
if we're just quickly, if we're talking about the grounds for believing in the Bible, I think we're now in a domain that is just completely separate from the question of metaethics at all, right? Like, I mean, whether you're a realist or an anti-realist, the question of what justification is there for believing that the Bible is accurate.
But again, these are the point I was trying to make there is that these are empirical facts, right?
Yeah.
These are things we can discuss without discussing morality or anti-realism or realism at all, right? Our hands are no more tied than are those of the realist. And if anything, I think the realist is in the worst position there, because they do believe that there are objective moral facts. So already the Christian doesn't have to deal with that. They you guys are on the same page, right?
Well, it depends on the Christian, because if they believe God, yeah, because you've got like God is it good because God says so, or is it, or you know, the other way around. So you could get like a realist in that sense. Yeah, but you do get that. But I totally get what you're saying. You're basically saying, at least if I understand, you're saying, you know, the anti-realist can go and say that they're wrong. They're not saying they're morally wrong. They're just saying they're wrong, factually, empirically wrong.
We can still say that they're morally wrong.
It's
just that we would have to give some alternative account of the moral discourse as having some function other than simply stating facts, right? So
I swear, isn't that just quasi-realism? Kane and I are just constantly trying to understand quasi-realism.
It's simply false that the sun is composed of an ideal gas, but there are lots of contexts in which it's useful to act as if the sun is composed of an ideal gas. And so in the same way, we can say there are lots of contexts where it's useful to act as if there are moral facts, even though there just aren't. That's the kind of line that I'm inclined to take about this.
That's interesting. Yeah. Well, yeah, no, you've given me a lot to think about, and I'm hoping that because yeah, looking at time, I probably should head soon. I'm really intrigued to see whether or not, because this conversation and the prior conversation we've had is just, for me, it's been wonderful. It's a really fantastic opportunity for me, and I hope I've not been too frustrating. But I'm hoping that yeah, like likewise to me, some people listening really got something out of the importance, especially on language, just the use of language, and yeah, so some of the other things that we've covered.
Stephen, there was something that you've brought up a couple times in this conversation and a few times before, and I think it's kind of the crux of why people like Kane and myself really strongly oppose people like Sam Harris doing this sort of thing. And I express my personal concern with it being maybe a little foolhardy to think that science can tell us, and that perhaps, you know, that's problematic in its own right. But the concern is that, all right, so you challenged us to find, like, list some anti-realists or philosophers of any sort, academic philosophers, who are out there doing stuff and that sort of thing. And I think part of the reason you don't see us doing that is a general caution. But I think a bigger part of the reason you don't see us doing that is because we make these distinctions, and it seems like the work we're doing is, in Harris's words, boring or uninteresting. None of us are trying to bore people. We don't create terms like metaethics or moral realism or anti-realism just for funsies. That's not us climbing in an ivory tower. It's because these distinctions are important to how you respond to ethical propositions, to how we understand each other and communicate, how you investigate problems like whether or not objective morality exists. And we need to have a common definition of these things in order to advance that conversation at all. Can you imagine trying to talk to somebody who identified as a realist only to discover that in fact they didn't think objective morality existed, and you just got on this tangent for no reason in particular? These are useful distinctions. And I think there's a good case to be made for colloquial language conventions moving closer to what academic philosophy uses, because these distinctions came about naturally, right? Somebody was arguing with somebody else. One philosopher was arguing with another philosopher, and they were like, my word, this person thinks that wrongness is built into kicking puppies. I never thought that at all. I thought they were just expressing a distaste for it. Or I thought that, right, this is really important. We're not doing it to bore people. I experienced the shock myself with you.
Yes, no, I'm just to put some icing on that cake, because I really hear what you're saying. When I was younger and I was getting into this, I was a little surprised to learn that moral philosophers really didn't take Sam Harris seriously at all. But now that I know more, I know why that's the case. So I hear what you're saying, absolutely. And it's not good enough to just shrug it off as boring language. That is actually, I would argue, irresponsible for the way that he did that. And I can understand the frustration, because to put it bluntly, he has to a degree taken a dump in your field. And then people are like, why is it that moral philosophers aren't really, you know, that keen in say steel manning Sam Harris or whatever? Well, there's a really good reason for it. No one's going to appreciate that in their field. It would be like someone going into, say, biology. I think you guys use this example in your conversation, or one like it. It would be like someone talking about biology and then not going, look, we're not going to talk about all the terms and about, you know, how certain types of mutations happen and whatnot, you know, because it's boring. And then also like doing a disservice to presenting it. And I think disservice is a strong word, but I do think there's reason to say that that's probably the right word to use. So I hear you. And I do think that point is not made enough, so I'm glad you've made it.
I want to be clear, it's not just that I'm insulted. I, to a degree, agree. Some of this stuff is boring, but it's not boring because it's irrelevant or pedantic or we're just in an ivory tower. It's boring because ethics are hard. They're really hard. There's this huge body of work that never tells you necessarily what you should do, and it doesn't get you to zesty conclusions like we have to stop mutilating women's vaginas or men's penises. I almost said men's vaginas. we have to, I mean, well, depending on how, yeah, what year this is, or we should let people carry on doing that. It doesn't do that. So I get that people feel like it's boring, but you're mistaking difficult, relevant, hard work and your personal reaction of being bored by that and not getting to these, oh, let's go out and do some shit type conclusions for being irrelevant or self-inflating. And it's not. We have these terms and these distinctions because they are useful for dialogue. They're useful for conversations. And hopefully they're useful for discovering facts about reality, which is what we're all trying to do. We couldn't have had this conversation or the conversation prior without this language. So that's my rant.